Hi, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody, wherever you're joining from today. My name is Suzanne Vaban, and I'm the co-lead of the Case Management Task Force of the Alliance for Child Protection Humanitarian Action. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to today's webinar on the launch of the revised Child Protection Case Management Guidelines and Forms. As we all know, child protection case management in humanitarian settings is a core approach that plays a vital role in safeguarding children during crises. Case management is central to providing individualized preventative and remedial support to children and their families, addressing some of the most severe and challenging situations that arise in time of crisis. The revised case management guidelines we'll introduce today, it aims to empower frontline staff, supervisors, managers across organizations to be able to deliver essential life-saving services to children who have experienced harm or at risk of abuse, neglect, exploitation, or violence. Since these guidelines were first developed in 2014, the Case Management Task Force has made significant steps to improve and standardize practices. While we've made progress, the context has grown more complex across different responses marked by increasing conflicts, climate-related crises, and unprecedented levels of forced displacement, which requires us to provide sustained investment and ensure collaboration. By hopefully being able to leverage these revised guidelines and integrating them with other tools and resources developed by the Case Management Task Force, we can provide quality, accountable, and sustainable services. Before we dive into the presentation, I wanted to take some time to just acknowledge the incredible work that has been put into developing and revising these guidelines. It was a long and tedious process. So a big thank you to the consultants who worked on this, Claire Sirukos and Elsa van der Straaten, who led the drafting process, and a big thank you to Marta Passerini, who finalized the work and will shortly present and introduce herself as well. This, of course, was made possible through a very strong interagency effort, including substantial time and contribution from numerous members of the Case Management Task Force, including many colleagues working in the field as well. This has ensured that these guidelines are hopefully comprehensive, effective, and in hopes that it will be able to provide essential support for child protection professionals in humanitarian settings. So I would now like to hand over to Marta Passerini to take us through both the guidelines and the forms. So over to you, Marta.
Thank you, Suzanne. And thanks everyone for joining. I see we're quite a good number. So good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. My name is Marta Passerini and I work for UNICEF and HQ on child protection case management and information management for case management. And indeed, I worked very closely with Ilsa and Claire, who are hopefully are here today on this piece of work. So just a little bit of a background of why we've updated the case management guidelines. And we'll start with the guidelines and then we'll move on to the forms. The first edition was published in 2014, and since then, a wealth of resources have been developed, which are related to case management or other areas of child protection, which are important to child protection case management work. Some of the most important ones are the second edition of the Child Protection Minimum Standards, which was updated in 2019, and I suggest everybody looks at, and then the UNHCR Best Interest Procedure Guidelines. But as I was saying, a lot of other resources, including for specific vulnerable groups like unaccompanied and separated children and children associated with armed forces and armed groups and so on, which are central to the work we do in child protection case management. So we really wanted to update the guidelines and we wanted to complement and include all the relevant resources that have been developed in the last decade. Next slide, please, Fed. So the process by which we went through this was we first reviewed 60 interagency resources that had been published since 2014. So really looked at what was out there. Most of them were completed, some were still in progress to make sure that we we had a good overview of what needed to be included in this new version. There was a number of key informant interviews that were held with around 28 technical experts, which were, you know, specializing in different areas of child protection case management and from different organizations and agencies and institutions. And then there was a survey that was sent out, and it targeted child protection caseworkers and their supervisors at the country level. And from that, we had 475 responses from 41 different countries. The survey was delivered in multiple languages. And so we received a lot of feedback on different areas of what, you know, people who use the guidelines wanted to see or did not want to see in what was going to be the final product. Next, please. So diving into the guidelines, because we'll dive deep more in future sessions. The audience was professionals that are involved in child protection case management. And we really wanted to speak to those who are working with children and families, of which I think we have many on joining the webinar today, but also those who oversee and support and design case management responses. And I see some names that I know play those roles. But we also wanted to speak to those who have coordination roles, be it in governmental bodies and UN agencies and NGOs and other civil society organizations. So different sections of the guidelines are targeted for the different audiences that we have. This was the result of quite numerous debates on whether we should focus on one group or all. And this was the final result. Next, please, Pedro. Now, in terms of structure, as I was saying, because we have different audience, we structured it so that different parts may be more relevant for certain roles in child protection case management work. So the first part is the foundations of child protection case management. It explains what child protection case management is, and it talks about the principles, it talks about some of the key approaches, and this is really for caseworkers and supervisors, but could also be for professionals in other roles who oversee case management programming. And that's because in designing this work, it's important for everyone to understand the foundations. Part two is around how do you actually design and strengthen a case management response. So this is really more about those who are supervisors and other professionals overseeing case management programming. And then the third part is on the case management process and the steps themselves. And this is really targeted to those frontline workers who are working with children and families. So caseworkers and supervisors. But having said that, all sections are important and relevant, in my opinion, for everyone. This is just to allow you to really zoom into and flip to the page or the section that you need in a specific moment. All the sections are linked. So if there's something in part three that's related to something that was said in part one, you will see that in the guidelines, this is linked and you can move quite quickly across the different parts and the different sections of the guidelines. Having been someone who used the 2014 edition in multiple, in different roles and contexts, I know how important it is to be able to go to the section that you need at times, but also to be able to see the totality of the guidelines. So we hope that the way we structured it really does help everyone in their different roles. Next, Pedro, please. So just some of the key highlights. And again, we're not going into all the details today, but we really wanted to introduce them as we will be uploading them today and everybody will have access to them. So these are some of the key highlights. So first of all, we have further developed certain sections. One of them is the principles, and we've really tried to show how the key child protection principles relate to child protection case management and how they're applied in the work of the caseworker and the supervisor. We have further elaborated the socio-ecological model and really explained how understanding the socio-ecological model and applying it can support case management work and work with that child, the family, the community, and the overall system. And we further developed coordination and how important coordination is, but also how important coordination within the child protection center section and externally plays a role in child protection case management. And this is true also of other sections that have been further developed, but I really wanted to to zoom in on D3 for today. We've created a link to our overall strengthening of the social service workforce. We know a lot of the time when we do child protection case management in humanitarian settings, we're also looking at how do we work within the child protection system? How do we strengthen the child protection system? So we tried to make that link to really make sure that our child protection case management work in humanitarian settings does not happen in a vacuum and is not thought out to be happening in a vacuum, but is ingrained in understanding what's happening and the mechanisms that are already in place. We've tried as much as possible to ensure complementarity with the best interest procedure and guidelines and understanding of settings with refugees. So you will see throughout the guidelines, certain mentions around refugee settings. These are highlighted with a specific icon. And this is because more and more, we have a lot of humanitarian settings that have mixed population groups that we work with, refugees, but not only. And so we really wanted to create clarity on how all of this comes together. We have new entries that are very much developed. One is on information management for case management, IM4CM for short, and the other one is on monitoring, evaluation, accountability, and learning. So we have two sections in this that really, I hope, help different professionals understand what their role is in terms of information management, but also in monitoring and evaluation. And we provide guidance on how to understand other related documents and how this really applies and is important for child protection case management. There's a stronger focus also on the role of the caseworker and on supervision. A number of tools have been developed on supervision in recent years, and we wanted to highlight how important that is in terms of supporting caseworkers to be able to deliver their job, ensure their well-being, and provide services of quality. And then finally, but not less importantly, the alignment to the quality assessment framework, which is a tool to understand where we are with child protection case management when we start working in a context or in a context that may have changed. And so you will see that the guidelines shadow the structure of the quality assessment framework. So as you roll out the policy assessment framework, which is one of the tools for case management of the Alliance, also you can quickly understand what needs to be considered to really design an appropriate response for child protection case management. Next, please. So now moving on to the forms. So you'll see on the screen what the forms look like now. It's quite different from before. Just a little bit of background on that. So there's been several iterations of the case management forms in the past. There was a number of requests from the fields as we were working with country teams and people and colleagues in different field postings. Then they needed to be streamlined. They needed to be more humanitarian friendly. A lot of countries were cutting them. They were removing sections, there was this feeling that they weren't just yet fit for purpose. In the meantime, we also developed a child protection case management data categorization. So this was really meant to give us a structure of data points that are fundamental to capture in child protection case management, but also define these data points. And so in child protection case management data categorization, we have defined what are the vulnerabilities and the key incidents of children. We have once and for all decided on what are the age groups we would be reporting on outwards. We have very well defined displacement categories or migration status, because what we were seeing was because the forms previously were long and there hadn't been a global agreement on certain fixed data points, there were a lot of differences across different contexts, which makes one looking at data very hard on child protection case management. It was also hard to tell the story of who are the children we're working with. And so in reducing the forms, we've also tried to simplify and really create a core that we would like remains there for us to have comparability across context. At the same time, we recognize that there will always be some of the adaptations that are needed for specific contexts, but hoping that we can maintain a slim core skeleton that does not change. And then lastly, we recently conducted a UNICEF case management research. We looked at hundreds of thousands of cases from different CPIMSs globally, of course, respecting all the data protection principles needed. But that really helped us on what were the data points and what parts of the forms were more problematic. So looking at the data being collected as caseworkers deliver child protection case management, it helps us understand which data fields there's mistakes in or which ones always are omitted. And so we use that together with data categorization to really influence the final version of these forms. And so whilst there's still many forms, we hope simplified them quite significantly. The formatting is also quite different. So it should be easier if you do have to make changes and you're using paper forms and not an information management system to be able to do so versus the previous version where by cutting a cell, a whole row was being deleted. I think those who've done that understand what I'm saying. So just to say, we've also tried to really look at the format and what the issues of the formatting in the past were. Next slide, please, Pedro. So the process for this. So a number of frontline workers in different country programs initially reviewed the forms and gave insights on what they thought worked well and what did not work well. So that was the first step. Then a number of global case management focal points for different organizations gave insights on how the different agencies were using the forms at times, how they were being used in different settings, but also learnings from specific responses. So there was a number of inputs given on certain forms and how they'd been adapted. And we saw consistency across contexts on the fact that certain sections were possibly being removed or being adapted. And so that was really important. And then finally, there was a mapping of all the data points. So to review all the duplications that existed and update the forms based on child protection case management data categorization. And again, those data points that we hope to be core that come from the data categorization process. Ilsa mapped every single data point on every form on an Excel sheet, every single one. And then we looked at them and we ensured there was no duplication across forms, but also made sure that they were really exactly what is necessary to deliver quality service, but not overwhelm caseworkers with documentation. Next, please, Pedro. So the audience. So here, our main audience is really those working with children. So the caseworkers and their supervisors, we really wanted to make sure these forms are easy and easy to work with for those who are working with children and need to do quality work, but also need to be able to document what is really essential for providing services to that child. However, this does not exclude those who are overseeing and supporting and designing, case management responses. Of course, we know that a lot of the time people in supervisory roles may be involved in discussions on how forms may be adapted. So of course they're for everyone. And of course, coordination we know plays a huge role in case management and the kind of final development of the forms at the interagency level in a specific context. So again, a very similar audience to the guidelines. However, really stressing the fact that we were really thinking about the caseworkers here and those who are using the forms day in and day out. Next, please. So the structure, you'll see there's still a lot of forms, but they are very, as I said, slimmed down and streamlined. And also most of them are, fit to one page. So we hope that really makes it easier to also be able to understand them and review them. So we have 5 core forms. I don't know if for those who have used the past, we used to have core and supplementary for every step. We've changed that a bit because part of the feedback that was that it was overwhelming to open all the steps and all the folders and understand whether one form could also apply, to multiple steps. We know case management is not a linear process. And sometimes, we do something and we kind of take a step back and reassess a child. And so we have now divided it as such. We have core forms, those are 5. There's an assent and consent form. There's a registration and rapid assessment form. There's a comprehensive assessment form, and then there's a case plan implementation and follow-up form, which is now combined. And then there's a case review form. And of course, case closure. So we've actually tried to also slim, but as well combine some of the forms. So as you're doing your case plan, you can already track the services provided and the follow-up needed. So you're not going in between forms, but it's all there right in front of you. Then we have a number of supplementary forms. These include case referral, even though we know in all contexts, we do referrals. Sometimes a referral form is not coming from the child protection case management deck, but it might be an interagency one. So we've put in supplementary. So we have that, and we have a case transfer form. Case review form is here. Apologies. And then we have a number of forms for unaccompanied and separated children in FTR work. I'm not going to get into all the details, but here we've really narrowed down to different steps. The most important form, I think, that I want to highlight today is the first one, which is supplementary to the registration and rapid assessment form. And it's the registration form for unaccompanied and separated children. And then you have a number of other forms that you would fill out if you were doing family tracing and reunification. Then we have supporting tools to be able to do to take case notes and, you know, track the different forms that you've been filling out and be able to have a cover sheet for that. And then we've included also the BIA and BID forms. So those are in there and they're part of that package. We do not want that to be a separate process or separate forms. It all has to come together. Again, noting that we have a lot of context where, you know, we have refugee children and non-refugee children. And then there's an overall introduction to the forms that explains what each form is for, who it's for, when to use it, but also explains how to understand the forms. So there are a few fields in the forms that are optional. So it explains that those are in italic in a certain context, in a certain color, and gives other such instructions to be able to navigate the format of the forms. Next slide, please, Pedro. So some of the key highlights. We have less fields overall and the forms are easy to edit. I was saying this at the beginning, so we've really tried to format them in a way that they're easy to edit. If you're using the paper forms, of course, we recommend, you know, secure information management systems when possible, but hopefully this will make everyone's life easier. We understand paper forms are often used in the first hours and days of a response. There's drop downs on vulnerabilities and incidents that are all aligned to this data categorization work that I was mentioning. So that's important. And what's really important, and this is in the guidance, is that these drop downs, some of these drop downs really not be changed. You may add maybe a little bit, but let's try and keep this. So across countries, we can say in a number of children who've been who have suffered violence versus abuse versus neglect, how many are unaccompanied, how many are separated in the same way. We really, really hope this score will help us improve our data, which will help us improve our work, which will help improve the quality of services we're providing. The core forms, I think, just to focus on those today. Assent and consent now is aligned with data protection principles. The former form was fine, but was missing some of the key questions that we should be asking. We should be asking children, not only if we can, you know, take their information for programming, but also to analyze data to improve services overall and so on. So that's all in there. As I said, registration and rapid assessment are now in one form. There was a feeling that having the registration form that had some unaccompanied and separated children components and a rapid assess and then another assessment form and then another assessment form was really too much. So we've put it together, and this is really a very important form. And if you cannot do a more detailed comprehensive assessment, then this is what you do together with the unaccompanied and separated children registration form, which is in the other deck. So this is really an important form and should be enough in a rapid onset if you're not able to complete form two, which is this detailed assessment form. So this we have marked as optional in large scale rapid onsets. We obviously advise that you do it. You may not be able to use this form immediately, but it's there for you to use it when it's appropriate. What we recognize that in many contexts, the assessment form was not being completed. And so we've really tried to include the core with the registration form. So you have the core necessary information to be able to help that child. And then, as I was saying, we have combined case plan implementation and follow-up. It's all in one place. In paper, it should be easier for a caseworker or supervisor to be able to see the totality of the actions taken and what's happening and the follow-up. Now, as I was mentioning at the beginning, when I was introducing the different categories of forms, unaccompanied and separated children and family tracing and reunification forms are all in one place. Before, they were split across the steps. Again, for those who were used to, who knew the forms in a previous version, we've kept them all together, noting that not in all contexts we work on unaccompanied and separated children, or not all agencies do family tracing and reunification. So for those who do, the forms are all there. As I said, the first form, Form 1 of unaccompanied and separated children, is essential to register that information. So if you come across an unaccompanied and separated child, you will fill out the registration rapid assessment form and that first form from the unaccompanied and separated children deck. The dropdowns are really important. So the key dropdowns are vulnerabilities and incidents, displacement status, care arrangements. And these are the four that I really wanted to highlight, because these are really important as we speak about child protection. You know, what are the vulnerabilities children face, and what incidents are they exposed to? What is their displacement status? Who are the population groups that we're working with, and who is taking care of these children? So we just really wanted to highlight those categories. Again, we will have follow-ups to these webinars, and we'll zoom into different areas. Next, please, Pedro. So next steps, what are the key next steps going forward? We want to start hosting targeted webinars in clinics for different actors and different roles. So, you know, whether you're a caseworker, a supervisor, or a coordinator, we will target specific presentations on the guidelines and the forms for your role. We will be looking at how to organize this starting the new year. And of course, then it will be published for different professionals to sign up at different times. We will also develop a video set explaining each form in detail. This is to make sure, again, that we keep that core, that skeleton that we really think is core, but also to help you understand how different questions may or may not be relevant depending, you know, specific situations. So what that will be developed in the coming months. And then I think just to highlight that the Child Protection Information Management System, the CPMS, will be updated to these forms. So as some of you may know, the Child Protection Information Management System in its basic instance has always reflected the interagency forms. So we'll tweak it to be able to reflect these forms. So in new responses, or as you know, there's changes in certain responses, you have the new forms in the system. And then just to highlight, there's a number of supporting guidance documents and checklists on specific themes that are being developed by different task forces of the Alliance. And this is because when we were developed the forms, we really wanted to make this set of forms apply to all children, independently from their vulnerabilities and their incidents, with the exception of unaccompanied and separated children, because the family tracing reunification process is so specific. So there's that deck. But really, we wanted to make sure that these forms could be used with children of multiple vulnerabilities and incidents, because we know that most of the children we work with don't have just one vulnerability or suffer from one incident, but a lot of time these are compounded. But there's also a recognition that there is a need sometime of guidance and further checklists to be able to help caseworkers and supervisors and other staff in different roles to be able to think through that form, but also think of it in relation to a specific vulnerable group or population. And so some of those are in the making. We will be uploading them as they come out. They may have their own dedicated webinars or launches, but just to flag that those will come and there will be additional support. So if you're working with children who have a specific vulnerability, you may have, for example, a shadow guidance that helps you tailor the questions in the assessment form accordingly. So that's coming too. And we really, really, really hope to see you in the webinars and the clinics. And we hope that once the videos are out, you will give us feedback, because this work is for you. It's for those who are working with children every day, and those who are supervising those working with children every day.
And we're so grateful for your time today, but also for the work in general, and really, really hope that both the guidelines in their updated version and the forms in their updated, hopefully simplified version, make everybody's work easier. And that's it for me. Back to Sazan, I think.
Thanks, Marta. I think we have some questions that were put in the chat box that we have time to now take a look at. Please feel free to continue to put questions in the chat because we have some time to address some of these questions. There's a lot of questions, Marta, around translation. Mm-hmm. Some people are asking if the forms will be available in French, both the guidelines and the forms.
Translation is happening right now of both the guidelines. The guidelines are being translated. The forms will be translated, as well as a number of other key materials that are related to the guidelines, and the translations being done into Spanish, French, and Arabic. We're doing that from the UNICEF side right now, and should be done in the new year. I wouldn't say before that. So for now, we're only publishing the English versions, but we will, of course, then have them translated and up on the Alliance web page. And then in the CPMS, they will be translated as they are now. I mean, we already have it. We'll have to move things around in the CPMS, thinking of that information management system specifically, because it's the most used by the case management task force, but there will be translations. We want to make sure as many people can access the forms, but only to these four languages. Yeah.
And then there are many people asking about where the forms and the guidelines will be available. Just to say, right after this call, and Pedro will be sharing the links, they will be available on the Alliance page. So both the guidelines and the forms. So we'll be sharing those, and then you can have access to both. There was another question, Marta, around how we looked at sub-thematic child protection training packages as well. And how we, while we were developing the guidelines, particularly how we ensured alignment with other kind of key sub-thematic child protection training packs, such as looking at children on the move, CAFAG, and et cetera.
Sorry, but what's the question exactly?
How we aligned, and how we considered different sub-thematic areas, child protection concerns and issues within the guidelines.
Thanks for the question. So we have an annex actually that looks at these kind of different groups of children who have certain incidents or certain vulnerabilities. So you will see in the guidelines, there's an annex that will take you through kind of the unaccompanied and separated children, or MHPSS. I think we use the same format as the child protection minimum standards, but we have tried to link. So whilst the guidelines, we tried to keep as neutral as possible and applicable to any child, because again, children have compound vulnerabilities and suffer multiple incidents. We do have some specific guidance on the different kind of groups that we work with in humanitarian settings. And we also have in the first annex, all the resources for certain groups and vulnerabilities. So you'll have a section on GBV, you'll have a section on accompanied and separated children, one on CAFAG and so on. You'll have all the other key resources for those thematic areas of work that then you can also access quite easily. I hope that answers the question.
Thanks, Marta. There's also some specific questions on the forms, and I know you covered this, but maybe just to highlight again, in terms of integration of the forms into the CPIMS Plus, and how that would impact colleagues who are using certain versions of the CPIMS right now. Once the forms are integrated into and the CPIMS is updated accordingly based on the new revised forms.
So your version of the CPIMS will not change unless you ask for a change. It's just the basic instance for new implementations that will automatically reflect the new forms. However, if you want to make changes to your current CPIMS instance because you plan on revising your forms for whatever reason, and you want to align the forms to the new set of forms, then we'll support in making the changes that
align the CPMS to the new forms. It's not huge changes. It's really about adding and removing some fields and standardizing some of the dropdowns. So it's not an impossible task. But no worries that those who have CPMS instances, they won't all of a sudden change. Those are the way they are. They will only change if you ask for support to change them. And of course, first, that would mean agreeing on a new set of forms/data fields at the interagency level, noting that in certain contexts, not all agents use the CPMS. So we're going to change the CPMS. It has to be because, you know, there's been agreement that the forms are being updated for all actors, right? We don't want to create a different process. But that is possible. Not mandatory, but possible. Absolutely.
There's a lot of worry and questions as well about contextualization of the forms, particularly on if there are specific guidance to be able to support country colleagues to look at what parts need to be contextualized, because the fear is that a lot of guidelines have been quite vague, which leave country colleagues with very little to be able to contextualize and take things forward, understand what can stay, what cannot, what needs to be changed. I know you've covered this already, but there's there's quite a lot of concern about adaptation, because I know we're trying to standardize as much as possible by looking at the data categories. And keep things kind of set in terms of the core minimum. But what does that mean to country responses in terms of adaptation and contextualization?
I'm trying to think of how to best answer that without going into explaining the whole process of data categorization and the research. And I know a lot of this work is on the forms, especially is based on two other products that we will be presenting on soon, but we really wanted to launch the forms because we have many countries asking us for the forms. By all means, we think adaptation is important, and we understand that that's necessarily a lot of the time also to comply to legal frameworks in different countries. I think what we've noticed, however, when we looked at the research piece, and we noticed this when we did the desk review for data categorization, is that, you know, across countries, the use of the word violence versus abuse, violence and abuse, physical and sexual violence were together, and then physical violence was in its own. It was quite messy. And so we really, really urge all countries to use these broad categories that we've not broad, these fixed kind of categories that we've created. And of course, can add certain other categories if really needed without making the list too long. The truth is, when we have a very long list of vulnerabilities and incidents, people mark too many or too little. And it's very hard to understand sometimes what is one incident versus the other when we have overlapping terminology. So the recommendation is, please use the core. If you really think the core that's been created in there is wrong, do reach out to us. By no means is anything ever perfect. So give us feedback. Suzanne and I think welcome feedback all the time from anyone. But what I wanted to say really is, if you need to add, that's great. I realize there's certain contexts where there may be specific issues that are not true of other contexts. We have a couple humanitarian contexts now where because of conflict, you know, we have a high number of children who are injured, and that has a huge impact on how case management plays out for these children. And so, for example, this may be added, or, contexts where there's a really high number of children who are in institutional care at the time the humanitarian crisis starts. And so you may want to mark that. But the core, when it comes to the key kind of abuse, violence, neglect, is there. And I would advise we don't break that up too much. Again, because in the past, we used to have abuse, violence interpreted in different ways by different organizations, by different contexts. And that makes it very hard for anyone to be able to understand who are the children we work with. The caseworker knows the details of that child case. Not everything, not all the details necessarily need to be moved upwards into data for us to be able to improve the way we work at the national, at the global level, at the regional levels, and so on. But if we could keep that core and then add one or two when needed, I think that would be the ideal situation. Having said that, This is all in the guidance that comes with the forms, and we will have a specific video clip on this explaining exactly the categories and where we advise or do not advise changes. I'm not going to go into the detail of every single field now because that would take hours probably, but just to say there will be more guidance. And in the meantime, do reach out if you have any questions on the dropdowns and on the forms. Please do reach out because we're happy to help you through the process of adapting them if you're indeed looking at revising your forms, which I know is happening in a few contexts.
I don't see any other particular questions. I'm sorry, I'm not able to keep up with the chat as well. So I don't know, Pedro, if you're able to follow the chat, if there's any specific questions, because I'm mostly looking at the Q&A box.
Oh, I see a CPIA online training. There's a few questions around training, Sazan. Maybe we could just point people also to the training materials that already exist. Sorry, I'm also skimming the chat in the meantime.
Yeah, so we can share different training materials. Of course, there's a lot of training material available on the Case Management Task Force Resource Hub, which we are now looking to revamp to hopefully make it easier for you to navigate different training resources. Just to say, there won't be specific training on the forms or the guidelines, but the idea that the forms and the guidelines are integrated and have been aligned with the core Child Protection Case Management Alliance training. But we could share a few links in terms of different resources that are available on the Case Management Task Force website. And if there's something specific or particular that you are looking for beyond today's topic, please do reach out, and happy to link you with the relevant colleagues as well.
Oh, I'm sorry, I saw a question on GBV. GBV case management continue to have their own forms. These are the ones that are specific for child protection case management now are recognized in certain contexts due to setup and legislation that may be all in one. So if you are in a context where you need guidance on which forms or approaches to use for certain children, for child survivors, please reach out for support. There are sections within the guidelines, the Child Protection Case Management guidelines, that explain the linkages to the recently updated Caring for Child Survivors Toolkit. So those linkages are in the guidelines, but always happy to guide into the specifics if needed.
There's a specific question, Marta, on the timeline and expectations in which the new tools will be used and the old tools dropped. And what's the expectations on that for country colleagues? Is there a timeline which they're expected to drop their old tools and align with the new tools?
The new tools will be available as of today. I mean, the guidelines are guidelines, right? So you use them as needed in your different contexts. We do advise, obviously, that you use the updated guidelines because they have sections that were not in old guidelines. And also they've been updated on the 60 resources that have been developed in the last 10 years. So if you're referencing, you know, if you need guidance on different aspects of child protection case management, please just look at the updated guidelines. When it comes to the forms, there is no expectation on you changing the way you work. These forms are available for contexts who are planning revisions of the child protection case management forms, or contexts that are, you know, developing child protection case management forms for, you know, new humanitarian needs currently. So we don't expect anyone to now, you know, go back and change all their forms. These are just available for those who are going and starting this process or a process of revision, to which we're always happy to provide support on, be it through the AR or, you know, through other coordination mechanisms or through our agencies, of course. I see more questions.
Yeah, there's a question on BIP, Marta, and linkages of the forms. Linkages of the forms to UNHCR's BIP process.
Yeah, was the UNHCR BIP procedure taken into consideration? Yeah, so UNHCR has been a key member of both the development of the guidelines and the revision of the forms.
They've contributed also to the introduction to the forms, explaining how the BIA and BID form fit into the wider package of forms. We wanted to make sure, again, as I said, that we are, you know, sensitive to all settings, including refugee settings, not because there's been confusion in the past, and rightly so. I mean, you know, a lot has been developed and further refined in recent years. And so we were happy to bring it all together. So you'll see throughout the guidelines, the linkages to the guidelines, the BIP toolbox, and other, you know, specific sections of the guidelines. So for example, in IM4CM section, we have specific link to, I think, section 3, of the BIC guidelines that talks about information management and so on. And you'll see that throughout and specific considerations. When it comes to the forms, our forms, the non-BIP BIA forms very much are similar to the old ones, where they're, you know, inclusive of all populations and independent of your displacement status. You'll see in your, you know, rapid assessment and registration form, you'll mark, you know, refugee, asylum seeker. If there's a need to then complete the BIA and BID based on the specific context, the procedures in the case, then that would be happening as it would have before. But we've really tried to bring them together so that there isn't a non-recognition that we have these other forms that need to be used for certain cases and certain situations.
Thanks, Marta. There's a lot of questions around whether already available training packages will be updated based on these revised guidelines. Actually, the guidelines were revised and updated based on the training packages, because as Marta mentioned, and as we mentioned early on in the webinar, that the first version of these guidelines were developed in 2014, and a lot of resources since then have been updated based on the changing context, including the Child Protection Case Management Training Pack, and then we also had the Coaching and Supervision Training Package as well. So when the guidelines were drafted and revised, these core Child Protection Case Management Training Packages were taken into consideration and were aligned with the guidelines as well. So some of what you see in the guidelines might be familiar to you if you're familiar with the Child Protection Case Management Training, but also things from the Coaching and Supervision Training Pack as well. So the training packages will not be updated, but the guidelines are now there to align with these new tools and resources.
Yeah, we have tried our best to be faithful to the updated training packages. Things happen at different times, and that's just the reality of our work sometimes. But I don't know in the training package, the section on the forms, if there is one, Suzanne, I can't think of it now. Maybe that's the only thing we need to look at. But in terms of like, what is case management? How do we design case management responses? What are the steps? What do we need to consider? That's very much aligned to what we have right now. So I wouldn't worry about that too much. And then in terms of like the CPMS part module and the case management in the training package and all that, that's all still very valid. So yeah, as Suzanne said, there's nothing wrong in the training packages, and everything has pretty much the same sense and alignment, mostly because the key principles are still the same, right? So that's the core, yeah. Oh, yes, guidelines and countries and legal frameworks, yeah? Yeah, the guidelines don't replace any legal framework. By all means, they will guide you actually to consider the legal framework. They give you a thought process on what to consider if in a specific context there's a need for additional specific work with some of the most vulnerable and high-risk children. And so it gives that insight on how you could increase the capacity of, you know, work with individual children, but also really flags the need to understand the social service workforce and system at hand before we do that. We know that in many humanitarian contexts, we need to increase the number of human resources because there's a higher number of children in need. And a lot of time this happens through kind of this case management work, but by no means are we superseding any kind of legislation or framework at the country level, but really want to work with and make sure we are serving the purpose of additional needs, which have been a result of, you know, a humanitarian situation. I see more questions.
There's a question on the quality assessment framework, because you mentioned, Marta, as part of the process that when we looked at the guidelines, it was aligned with the quality assessment framework. There's a question as to whether this tool will be updated. Just to say, yes, it is in the work plan to update and revise the tool, the quality assessment framework, so that to make it a bit more applicable, a little bit easier. Hopefully then in looking at the guidelines, aligning the quality assessment framework as well with the new revised guidelines. There are a few pieces that are upcoming, like Marta mentioned, as part of the Case Management Task Force work plan, that kind of all fits into this process, including the data categorization piece, looking at standardized indicators for child protection case management as well, that all align with the guidelines, with the revised forms and other key tools and packages that the task force has been working on.
I think we're almost at time, but we have a couple more questions. I'm glad we left time for questions, which is what we wanted to do, because we know a lot of the time we talk and then there's not a time to answer them. But these are great questions. I think I see one on Cox's Bazaar. By all means, if you want to use these forms, go ahead. Just, you know, whether it's appropriate for your context based on, you know, the context and, you know, the status of the response. I can't advise on specific context, you know, without, but if it's, go ahead and use the new versions. I think there's something around disability inclusion. I find that really interesting. So we do have a section in the guidelines around children with disabilities. It's not a whole guideline. It's just a part of the guidelines, right? Because there's so many things to cover. But there are additional tools that exist around working with children with disabilities that we created linkages to. Now in the forms, we have included a number of data fields that really mark what are the disabilities that we want to document. In the past, when we look at data, there's very little information on children with disabilities. And so there are categories that are based on the Washington group scale that have been included in the forms. So that is in there. Now, in terms of that additional kind of nuance of how do you work with children with disabilities and so on, again, I think that's one of those areas where there's other tools that we link to, and or that might be something we want to have a checklist with, or something that guides that caseworker as they're using the forms. But it's not, as I was saying, we try to not create forms. If we had to create forms for every vulnerability or incident, it would be very hard, right? And so we've tried to keep them as neutral as possible and adaptable to the needs of, you know, children who are facing different risks and vulnerabilities. And so, but happy, you know, I don't know, Susanna, if there's anything under works around disabilities and the case management task force. And right now, off the top of my head, I couldn't tell you where all the resources, but I know there's a lot that's out there. But if that, you know, if that's a gap, then that's great for us to know, I think.
I think maybe, Marta, also fair to share that what we've tried to do as part of the guidelines is also share all the key resources and link some of the key resources. So you'll see in the annex of the guidelines all the tools and resources. And yeah, of course, if that's still a gap, there's nothing in the plans for the case management task force at the moment. But if that is a gap, then it's something we can look at potentially in the new strategic period.
But also do share what you develop at the country level. I mean, a lot of the work we've done on the guidelines and forms are also, you know, based on things that already existed in different responses. So I see South Sudan is developing something at the case management task force in South Sudan on, you know, being able to integrate disability related perspectives in interagency formats. By all means, once that's done, make sure you do share it with us so that it's available to others, and we continue to collect this for others and for the future when we do updates. Anything else?
I There's a lot on there's a lot on training packages and et cetera. Please feel free to reach out to the case management task force directly if there are specific training packages that you're looking for related to child protection case management, and I'm happy to help. Just to say again, I think there's a lot of questions as to where we can access the forms and guidelines. Pedro will be dropping the links into the chat that you're able to access, and they'll be available on the Alliance site right after the call. So you'll be able to access both the guidelines and the forms. And as Marta mentioned, this is just the start. We just wanted to launch them, to go over them briefly, and then hopefully in the new year we're planning to have more detailed webinars at regional level, at response level, to provide the needed support to either roll out the case management forms if your country is planning to pick those up, but also more to go into more detail on the guidelines to provide more support to country colleagues and responses. So this is just the start. We wanted to end the new year in launching a very awaited resource and very important resource, and I think a core resource for child protection case management. And then hopefully in the new year, we can deep dive a lot more into both the forms and the guidelines and a lot of new resources that will be coming up in 2025 as well with the child protection case management task force.
Thank you. Just before I mute myself, I just wanted to thank everybody that attended the webinar. I hope the presentation wasn't too long. I know how tedious it can be to sometimes to listen to explanations of documents that you're going to read. So hopefully we said just enough, and I do look forward to continuing this conversation. And again, thank you so much to Ilsa and Claire who drafted the guidelines, and to everybody that contributed. It took a tremendous amount of time from so many people, including Suzanne and Camilla, who I see on the chat, who's the one of the coordinators of the Alliance. But just a big thanks to everyone, really.
Thanks, and everybody.
To Pedro, who allowed, to set up the webinar. We forgot Pedro. Sorry, Pedro.
No worries. Thank you guys so much.
Thanks, everybody, for joining. And again, please feel free to reach out if you have any questions in the meantime.